good, everybody? Justin here again. Welcome back to my YouTube channel. I know I've been loafing on posting the last couple months, but the world's ending, so give me a break. No, in all seriousness, I have been loafing even before the pandemic happened, but I'm gonna try and start posting regularly again, hopefully every week, if not more. Today, we're gonna be doing a Q&A. I asked my Instagram followers to send some questions my way in regards to film, video, or anything to do with my life, really, so let's get into it right away. So I'm just gonna try and jump through these questions as quick as possible. I'm gonna give detail in the more specific questions, but I just don't really wanna have a 15 minute long video, so bear with me. Okay, question number one is, what hobbies inspire you to be more creative? So things that inspire me to be more creative are basically other forms of creativity that I'm not, I guess you could say, a professional at, things I haven't put my 10,000 hours into. So I'm a huge fan of stand-up comedy. I'm not a stand-up comic myself, but I can appreciate the artwork that goes into it and the creativity. So anything like that that takes a creative skill and I can see people doing it at like the top of their field, that really gets me inspired. Other things are things like skateboarding. A lot of creativity goes into that and I grew up doing it my entire life. So anytime I see something creative where people are really pushing the boundaries of what's possible, it really inspires me. Okay, the next question is, hello J Boulevard, can you comment on my latest post? No, next question. Okay, so the next question is, what is my 5-year goal and my 1-year goal? So for 5 years, I really want to build a self-sustaining business that I can hire on staff that take care of most of the day-to-day stuff, and I can kind of just oversee it.
How is this not a pyramid scheme?
All right, let me explain.
I want it to be mostly digital, with a few exceptions where I have people going out and shooting, and I can oversee those projects, as well as the animations that are going on. I definitely want to not limit myself to have to work in one specific place. Like, I've been working for myself for the last year or two, and I really like the freedom that I have being able to work from my laptop anywhere. So, sort of a digital nomad, I want to be able to oversee bigger projects, but from anywhere in the world, so I can still run a business, but also travel and work on my passion projects. And in terms of my 1-year goal, I really want to make a more specific plan on how to make that 5-year goal a reality. I'm not sure 100% what that looks like right now, but I think that's a great direction to go for just in terms of my lifestyle. Another very specific goal I have, I think it's good to have very specific goals because then they're actually very tangible, is to have one of my motion graphics up on a digital billboard in Times Square. I visited Times Square for the first time about 3 months ago with my girlfriend, and just the thought of having my work up on a screen that big in front of that many people is unreal. In the past, I've had the opportunity to have some of my work on smaller billboards in a bunch of malls all around Canada, which is really cool. So I think that's the next realistic step. I'm not sure how I'm going to achieve that yet, but it's definitely in my mind and something that I want to work towards this year. All right, the next question is, how do you find the angle? Yeah, this is stupid. Next question. Okay, keep in mind, some of these questions aren't necessarily film or video related, and some of them are just plain out stupid, and I thought they were funny because I have friends online that like to mess with me, so I'm gonna try and go through those as well. Not sure if they'll make it in the video, but it'll be funny either way, so let's do it. Okay, this one's kind of weird, but I'm gonna go through it anyways. It says, do you think revenge is warranted when someone fucks you over? I wanna say no, but I'm pretty petty on a personal level, if I'm being honest. So yeah, obviously sometimes I've probably seeking revenge, but I'm gonna say in terms of business, it's probably best to just be the bigger person because you're gonna do nothing but hinder your opportunities by trying to get someone back. I mean, I always say success is the best revenge. So if you look at it that way, yeah, but other than that, it's probably not worth it. Okay, moving on to some more technical questions. This question is 1080 or 4K timeline. To be honest, I think it depends on what footage you mostly have. If you're shooting all 4K and it's like a bigger project and your computer can handle all that and you're just equipped to work with 4K files, go for that totally. In the end, it'll be better quality. But I do want to mention that a lot of the times when I'm shooting anyway, I'm on a mirrorless camera, a Sony a7S II, so I can only shoot 4K at 24 frames per second. And a lot of the time when I'm getting B-roll, like 60 frames or 120 frames, it's going to be in 1080. So my rule of thumb is whatever I have more of in my timeline, whether it's 4K footage or 1080 footage, I'll make the timeline that size and then export at that. I'd rather have 4K footage that I have to scale down to 1080 instead of the other way around, and then you're losing quality when you're blowing the 1080 footage up. So I would say rule of thumb, whatever you have more of in your timeline, export at that. I mean, end of the day, if it's going on Instagram, you're not gonna be able to see the full quality anyways. So you're probably gonna wanna just do it at a 1080 timeline so you can, you know, speed up the process. Okay, so the next question is prime lens or zoom lens? I wanna say prime lens, but I think they're both good for different scenarios. If you're doing something more run and gun and you have to switch your lens a lot, it's gonna be a pain in the ass. So if you have a zoom lens, you can kind of take one lens and then use it for a bunch of different situations. So in that respect, zoom lenses are great, but if you have the option to shoot all prime lenses, that's ideal. Like if you're on a music video set and you have the opportunity to have a 16 mil, a 24 mil, a 35 mil, a 50 mil, an 85, and then super long telephoto lens, whatever it is. Yeah, that's great. All right, so this question is, what frame rate do I find is the best for exporting music videos? Personally, unless you're doing something kind of out of the ordinary, you're gonna almost always wanna export at 24 frames per second. I see a lot of people exporting music videos, and I've done it myself on my very first music video. I shot it all at 60 frames per second, and I exported all at 60 frames per second, and you just get this weird sort of unreal frame rate. So you're gonna wanna always export at 24 frames per second to get the most cinematic results. But hey, go ahead, experiment with your frame rates. Maybe you'll stumble upon a new look and then it'll blow up and then I'm gonna look stupid only shooting 24, so. Okay, so this question is, what is my favorite picture profile? So for me, I shoot almost always on picture profile 6 in the Sony a7S II. It's a really flat profile, but it doesn't limit you on how low you can go on your ISO. So if I'm shooting outside and it's really bright, but I still want that flat image profile, I'll use picture profile 6. And that way I'll have enough dynamic range in my raw footage to sort of go in and color correct very specifically later on. I did, however, used to shoot all the time on picture profile 8, which is a little more flat of an image, but it does restrict you to shooting at least 1000 ISO. So I kind of just got in the habit of doing picture profile 6 because there's no ISO limitation on there. As long as you're shooting some sort of flat picture profile and you're decent with color correction, you should be fine. All right, what is this one? When did you know it was time to go freelance full time? So this is actually a funny story for me. I didn't really get to choose that I was gonna be going freelance full time. Obviously it was always a goal of mine and like something that I was working towards, but I think I got caught up working full time jobs that I really didn't have to put too much effort into. There were still video jobs like working for marketing departments and stuff, but the last job I had like that was working for this lunch bag company. I'm not gonna say the name, but it was super unmotivating and I didn't realize till after that it was really killing my creativity because I was just going in and doing like just going through the motions and making these boring ass like corny videos for kids lunch boxes, and it's not something I was really into. So I started slacking a lot, honestly, and ended up working on like my own video content while I was at work about 50% of the time. And eventually I think they kind of caught on and saw me working on that stuff and gave me the boot and fired me.
You're fired.
Which was kind of a great blessing in disguise. As much as I was like worried I wasn't gonna be able to make freelance money right away, it just sort of forced me to like dive headfirst into freelance because I didn't want to get another job like that where I was just uninspired. And yeah, I've been working for the last year and a half, 2 years freelance full time, so it worked out. I wouldn't suggest quitting with no like backup plan or without some money saved so you have a cushion, because it adds a lot of stress, but sometimes that pressure can make diamonds and it can force you to do something that you may have been too scared to do originally. But yeah, definitely try and save up some money if you're thinking about going full time, and just know that if it doesn't work out, you can always go back and find other jobs like that. Okay, this one says, who's the coolest person you've ever shot for? So I get asked that question a lot, and it's usually between three people. I've had the opportunity to shoot Tristan Thompson a couple times. I shot Drake's show when he was here on the Aubrey and the Three Amigos tour. That was a really great show to shoot. Probably my favorite live show I've ever shot. But I think the coolest person that I've ever shot with is probably Floyd Mayweather. I had the opportunity to shoot him twice just because an artist I work with is a part of the Money team. So I've been back and forth to Vegas a lot. I've spent some time with him out in LA. Yeah, so the first night that I ever met the Money team, we were at this sort of hookah lounge and we were filming a music video and ended up shooting Floyd, a bunch of the Money team guys, and just meeting everyone. It was super cool. Ended up going back to Mayweather's house afterwards. Just chilled with his family and his kids, actually. It was super weird, like surreal. Like, what am I doing here? Like, this guy, I grew up listening to 50 Cent and this guy's beefing with him and like talking about it in front of me. And I'm just like, why am I even here, really? So it was pretty surreal, but it was also really, really cool. Like a cool experience just to be at that guy's house. Like, I actually shot another music video at one of his other houses, which should be dropping soon, and it's like the craziest house I've ever been into. So that was probably the coolest experience I've had shooting someone in particular. Okay, this one says, what was the first music video you ever made? And this one is actually funny. It was actually one for my cousin KG about 7 years ago when I first moved here and I was just starting school. I had like a little Canon T3i. Him and I went out downtown Toronto and just filmed a music video for this song, Come Clean, he did. It was actually like a remake of a J.Ru the Damager song, if anyone knows that, Come Clean. He just put his own spin on it, same beat, and just rapped a new song. And we went out and filmed for about 2-3 hours and just ended up putting together a full music video. And it did pretty good for the time. It was like 3-4,000 views. But yeah, that was the first video I ever shot. It's crazy to see how far I've come. I guess not such a short period of time. It's still 7 years ago, but just to see where I started and where I am now, it's pretty cool. This one says, hey, J Boulevard, please go follow my page. It's not really so much a question as much as a demand. So no. Okay, this one says, what editing software do you use? So I primarily use Adobe Premiere for just regular editing, just linear cutting and stuff like that. I do use After Effects a lot, especially for motion graphics and animation, as well as some visual effects that can be done in Premiere. And I'm also getting back into using Cinema 4D as well, which is sort of 3D modeling. You may have seen some of my videos I've posted recently with 3D models of shoes and stuff. I'm trying to diversify my portfolio so I can hopefully work with bigger companies that need that sort of work. But for the most part, Adobe Premiere, Adobe After Effects, and anything in the creative suite. Okay, another film question. This one says, how long on average is your whole process from start to finish? So this is a really kind of vague question. It could be anywhere from 20 minutes of shooting to an hour of editing, or anyway from like 4 full days of shooting to like 200 hours of editing. It really depends on the project, but let's just say for a standard music video, I could shoot one of those in 2-3 hours and then edit it in, you know, 3-4 hours.
He's so fast!
He did it right!
Depending on how effect heavy and how deep I want to go with the editing, but to get something put out that not necessarily that I'm proud of, but that I would be comfortable showing to people, it's probably 2-3 hours shooting and then maybe 4-5 hours max editing. So under 10 hours for a basic music video. We'll say that. Let's see what the gram's saying. Oh, also, if you haven't, go follow me on TikTok. Some of my best content is on there, honestly. It's not even like film really related stuff, just me being an idiot. If you like a quick laugh, go show that some love, because it's kind of what I'm using to keep sane during this whole quarantine thing. So go check it out if you want to. All right, moving on. Okay, so this next question is a really good one. It says, how do I get started? Asking for a kid with no experience. So I think the best thing about getting started today is that everyone has a smartphone and everyone's smartphone shoots HD video. So what I would say is find out what you want to make videos about, whether it's video games, skateboarding, or anything like that, stunts in your backyard, and then go on YouTube and see what kind of videos people are making around those subjects. And then once you know what kind of video you would like to make, draw inspiration from those, but try and find a way to put your own twist on it. And it's not gonna happen overnight. You're gonna learn and you're gonna grow, but that's a great way to start, is draw inspiration from others and then make it your own. Another thing you're gonna wanna do is, if you're shooting on your cell phone, go to the App Store and find a free editing software. There's a bunch of them, so you can do everything in your phone. If you're just starting out, don't worry about getting any fancy equipment or a new computer to do the editing on. Just find out what type of videos you like to make, and then slowly you'll learn how to do that. And then when you get to a point where you want to start investing in some equipment, you know that you actually enjoy the process as opposed to the idea of making videos. You know what I mean? So I think that's a good starting point, but feel free to reach out to me. I'm always down to lend a helping hand and share my knowledge. So hit me up if you have any questions that I don't answer in this video. In terms of the technical side of things, YouTube is going to be your greatest teacher. I took 4 years of film school, and I can honestly say I taught myself 90% of what I know by watching YouTube tutorials. That and reaching out to people years ahead of me and just asking tips and tricks is a great way to learn. Honestly, film school is kind of dead in my opinion. Everything you need to learn is on the internet, so just do some searches, do some Googles, and there's never-ending amounts of information. Also, don't be afraid to reach out to people years ahead of you. Like I said, 99% of the time, those people aren't going to be bothered by you asking or annoyed. They're going to want to help you because they're going to relate to you because they used to be that person probably. You know what I mean? I know I was, and reaching out to people was definitely a way to learn and just network in general. Okay, this one is also a good one. It says, what's the hardest shot you've pulled off? That is a tough question. I think the hardest shot I ever pulled off was this one shot in this music video I shot and directed out in LA called LA Chronicles with my two buddies, Ray and Easy. Shout out Ray and Easy and the whole crew that helped make that possible. We were actually staying in Inglewood, kind of in the hood, and we were right on this busy like boulevard, but it was 2 a.m, so the street was completely dead and we had a rental. So I had the idea to start at like our Airbnb, like on the front porch that we were staying at, and get one continuous shot that spanned all the way down the road and ended at another car in like the parking lot across the street, but it was going to be all one take. So what I had to do is be on my gimbal and pull out backwards from the front of the house and then sit smoothly in the open trunk of the car. And while that happened, the artist Ray started running and performing, and then we had to follow him in the car, and then I got off the car about halfway down and then transitioned to Easy, who started rapping as well, and then walked across the street and got into another car and then rolled away. It's not the hardest shot, but it was just this whole scenario going around. It's just one long take. The music was being played at double speed because we wanted to do the slow-mo and post effect. So yeah, there was just a lot of moving parts that made it really challenging to pull that shot off. I know we tried it like probably 9 or 10 times. And on the last go, we actually got pulled over by the police asking what we were doing and kind of just being confused why we were out in the hood at like 2 a.m. with like a group of us just filming, you know what I mean? So it was just a cool story and the end results looked really cool. So probably one of my more challenging shots just based on the situation we were shooting it in. Okay, so this next question is a good one, happens to a lot of us. It says, have you ever underpacked for a shoot? And if so, what did you do to compensate? So I think one of the best ways to kind of compensate for not showing up with something that you needed is obviously first always be prepared, but that's kind of a cop-out answer. I would say I think the best way to compensate for something like that is just to make sure you're diverse with all of your gear in the first place. So for example, I use a lot of stabilized or gimbal footage in my edits, but a few times either my stabilizer wasn't working or I didn't have access to one. So I was able to compensate by knowing that no matter what, I'm skilled enough to make this edit work, even if I'm shooting handheld, whether it's using different techniques for being still to make that smooth shot still happen, or just finding new ways to make the shot happen without being on a stabilizer. I'm not sure if that's a great example, but that's really the only thing I can think of in my head. I would just say, do your best to be prepared because best offense is a good defense. Is that the quote? Let's go with that one. Okay, this one says, what are the tips you have for preserving your camera? I'm honestly probably one of the worst people to talk to. My camera's not in great shape. It still shoots perfectly fine, but it's definitely been through some shit. I was shooting a music video out in the Dominican Republic, and the artist told me that we were gonna shoot some ATV scenes, which I thought was super dope because I wanted to be on an ATV. But what they didn't tell me is that it was like an 8-hour long trek through like knee deep mud, and my camera got obliterated. Like, I'm not even kidding. Like, I don't know how it still works this day. Looking back, I probably should have told the artist I'm not comfortable with doing this, but I really wanted to make the video work, so I did put my gear in jeopardy, which I kind of regret, but the footage turned out great, so kind of a win-lose situation. Do your best to protect your gear. There's a lot of accessories out there, like camera bags that'll cover your stuff if it's raining and stuff. Look into your options and try and prepare yourself as much as possible for the conditions of the shoot. Also, use your cases. If a camera comes in a case, it's meant to be in that. So like with my stabilizer, it kind of broke after like 3 years of abuse because I never carried it in the handbag. So if something like that comes with protective gear, try and use it as much as possible. So moving on, have you ever posted work you're not proud of? Okay, so the short answer is yes, but the long answer is not so much anymore. I think I'm at a point with my work and my career that I have enough of a pre-existing portfolio that I don't have to post stuff just for the sake of showing that I've done a lot of work. I think early on, I was kind of just posting stuff to like bulk up my portfolio. But at this point, I've done enough work that I can really be particular about what I post and what I show. So you'll notice I shoot a lot of music videos that don't end up on my page. Not that I'm not proud of them, but it's just kind of, I already have work that will show that skill set. So there's no point in overproducing or overposting. Obviously post as much as possible. That's great for engagement and stuff like that. But you want people to be anticipating your videos to drop because they know it's gonna be something unique, not the same video over and over, just to a different track. So I would say in short, quality over quantity always, but make sure you have a good amount of quantity to begin with. You also have to realize not everything you do is going to be your best work. So I do a lot of corporate work and I would love to make it 10 times more polished, but a lot of times clients just want good and they want it finished ASAP. So speed is a big factor. So if you can get something the client's happy with, I think that's a win in your books anyways. So definitely do that. The projects I spend a lot of time on now and stress over is funny. It's a lot of the times passion projects now because I've learned to detach myself from client work because they're going to have a vision. And as long as you get it to them how they want it to look, then you succeeded. But I could put all this energy in and make it perfect in my mind, and if the client doesn't like it, that's still a lose. So it's kind of a balancing act. All right, this one just says three money bag emojis. So gang gang.
I get that paper boy.
Yeah, no, respect, I guess, thanks. All right, moving on. What is a must-have item in your gear bag on every shoot? For me, I would say, other than obviously a camera, my stabilizer. Like I said earlier, I use a lot of gimbal footage in my shots. So yeah, it's just a really dependable thing that can get you a full range of dynamic shots, from acting as a tripod if you just need to stand still, or following someone down a hallway for 20 minutes tracking them. It's very diverse, and I think it's kind of my go-to rig. But having said that, don't fall into the trap of only shooting on your stabilizer. Definitely try and diversify your skill set. But me in particular, I would say the most important piece of my gear bag is some sort of stabilizer. What is the hardest part about making music videos? It's a good question. I would say for me, coming up with something different and unique, especially when I'm banging out so many music videos in like a month, trying to find new ways of doing stuff that's not just the traditional standing in a cool area, doing a performance and then getting some B-roll, trying to find ways to be creative and unique and tell different stories, I think is probably the hardest part. But yeah, that's the part I like the most. That's the challenging creative part. So it's the hardest part, but it's also the most rewarding part, I would say. This one says, hey, I just wanted to let you know that I think you have fantastic content. I don't know who you are, but I appreciate you. I try my best to keep pumping out good content, and I'm glad that it's being received well by someone. So thank you. Thank you. All right, so we're pretty much done. This last one says, would you consider getting into porn? If so, what effects would you use? I mean, I'm not gonna discriminate. I'm not gonna go out and look to shoot porn, but if someone offered me a bag to do it, I would do it, and I would use a bunch of star transitions, just like Movie Maker style, zoom, zoom. Because porn's definitely missing that creative edge with the star transitions. And finally, it says, follow me, I got you, no cap. I don't know, that sounds pretty cap, bruh. I guess we'll see. Yeah, so that's basically all the questions I have today. I'll probably do another one of these in a month or so. I'm gonna try and keep posting once a week, like I always say, who knows? I have a lot of client work that I have going on, so that always takes a priority. But with all this extra free time right now, I'm gonna do my best to be posting consistently on YouTube. Thanks for watching, like and comment on the video. Turn on my post notifications if you wanna get notified anytime I drop a video. And yeah, let me know in the comments below if you have any other questions. I'll do my best to answer them, and hopefully this was helpful. So stay tuned. Peace.